Okay, just enough physics, chapter two, forces. So in chapter one, we just described one-dimensional motion for objects with constant acceleration. And remember, the goal here is to get to just enough. We're not going to do all the extra things. I want to just do the basics because I can't go on forever. Okay, but this is going to be great. I really am excited because look, we have things like I have props, I have a ball. I have people like Aristotle. We're gonna have a great conversation. Okay, so let's get started with the show. What is force all about? Okay, so let's start with Aristotle. And you know, it's kind of like, hey, who cares about Aristotle? But there's an important thing about these Greek philosophers, and they were mostly philosophers, they were not scientists. Okay, so in this case, they did what's called deductive reasoning. And I'm going to misspell it, deductive. And later we get to inductive. So you know this. Think of this as the Sherlock Holmes. Okay, so Sherlock Holmes makes some observations and say, well, it's you know, here are basic things that we all assume to be true. And from that, I can figure out all the details. So this is kind of like a triangle like this, right? If I assume this to be true, then I can figure out all these details. So it's a top-down triangle. You're going that way. And that's what these Greek philosophers did. They said, okay, if I push an object, it moves. If I stop pushing, it stops. We all agree on that, so we don't have to do anything about that. But so what does that say about the nature of forces in motion? That was the deal. And then later we'll get to science, which is more inductive reasoning. So you collect all these pieces of evidence, and from that you build one big idea. So it's from evidence, details, up to the big idea. The Greeks did big idea and then work out all the details. Okay, so that's that. Okay, so Aristotle started with something like this. Here's a block. He goes, hey, what happens if I push that block? Oh, there, it stopped. If I push it again, it moves. If I stop pushing, it stops. So for him, he had the following nature of interactions. Okay, and it starts with things like this, a rock. A rock is made of earth, and earth things want to get down here. They want to fall to the earth. Bloop. So a rock falls. Okay, what if I have water? Wait, that's air. That's water. See, it's got a raindrop. And by the way, that's not what raindrops look like. We draw raindrops that way, but that's another story. Okay, so water wants to get down to the rest of the water. So that's also with the earth. So these things fall. Bloop. Okay, what about air? Air moves, I guess, horizontally. I don't really know what that does. It doesn't fall. Okay, and then I have, so that's earth, wind, water, and of course we have fire, and fire rises. Okay, so things have these natural motions. They want to get to where they should naturally be, and most things are made of earth-like materials, so they fall to the earth, wind, and fire, water too. Okay, so what if I take let's not use the ball, so go back to this block. So if this block is sitting on the earth, that's its natural state. The natural state of this is to just be on the surface of the earth at rest. And if Aristotle comes up and pushes it, it'll move. But once he stops pushing it, it stops. So it returns to its natural state. That's what Aristotle said. And it makes sense. So no one really argued with him. And this is what we had for, you know, 2,000 years. People said, what did Aristotle say about motion? Well, he said, I'm Aristotle. And if you push it, it moves. If you stop pushing it, it stops. So that's Aristotle's law of motion. The natural state of something is to be at rest. Okay, so what about an experiment? So later someone said, you know, I don't know, let's just try something out. What if I take a very shallow incline like that and I put a ball on it, then I let it go? What happens? It turns out that the time it takes to go here is different than the time it takes to go there, and so forth. So we can see that it does not move at a constant speed, and it in fact speeds up. If I change this and make it just slightly inclined, then it just rolls along at a constant speed. Okay. If I put it at a completely flat, it almost rolls at a constant speed, but eventually slows down and stops. And that's what Aristotle say. Aha, see? It stops. I told you everything stops. But Galileo found... Oh, here's my Galileo. Hi, I'm Galileo. Don't forget about me. See, I made the little guys. It's because I care. I care about you and physics and Galileo, and he gets left out all the time. So this ball, if I have just the right incline, I can move it along at a constant speed with no forces pushing on it. Okay? So Galileo said, I think there is something going on here. In an idealized world, then this would be flat and it would move along at a constant speed. But since it's not ideal, then I have to have it inclined a little bit and it rolls down. But he gets to the idea, well, one, objects accelerate. They do not move at a constant speed if they roll down the track. And if you have a idealized case, then it could move without any force at all. And then this guy comes in to take all the credit for everything. And he says, and he's not the only one. Okay, we like to say Newton's laws of motion. But this is the let's look at these. You've seen these before. Newton won. And people say, oh, what does that even mean? This is the nature of motion. Let's see. Yeah. I'm gonna say nature of motion. The natural state. So Aristotle said the natural state of an object is to be at rest. Newton says the natural state of an object is to be moving at a constant speed, just like what Galileo has said. If you leave it alone, it's going to move at a constant speed. If you push on it to stop it, it'll stop. Okay, that's a pretty big idea. Okay, that says, no, it's not going to be at rest. If you leave it alone, it could keep moving in a straight line. Big idea. Newton, too, is this. He says that... Actually, if you push on it harder, it will have a greater rate of change of speed than if you push on it not as hard. And also, if you increase the mass, it will have a lower rate of change of speed. So you get this in one dimension, F net equals MA. And that A is the same acceleration that we had before, but this is a relationship between the total force and the acceleration. Now, this is not the best way to write this. There's actually a couple other ways to write it. We'll talk about that soon. This is only in one dimension. Don't get on my case, okay? Because I'm going to get to two dimensions and three dimensions later. Okay, N3 says forces come in pairs. Okay, so this says that... Let's take an example. Suppose I live here in Louisiana. It's a bad picture. And there's Hammond. And there's Baton Rouge. And it's maybe, let's say, 50 miles west. So if I go from Hammond to Baton Rouge, I go 50 miles west. What if I want to go from Baton Rouge to Hammond? Well, it has to be the same distance. Okay, but it'd be east. So I have 50 miles west, 50 miles east. Really, it's the distance between Hammond and Baton Rouge is 50 miles. I can go either east or west to get to there, whichever way I want to go. And that's the same thing that's true for forces. If I have, I'm trying to think of a good example. How about this? If Aristotle pushes on Galileo with a force of 10 newtons, then to the right, then Galileo has to push back on Aristotle with the force of 10 newtons to the left. Because really, it's the interaction between these two. Okay, and that's what Newton's third law says. It says that forces are an interaction between two objects. I know this is a lot, okay, but just calm down. We're going to get there. Okay, let's look at a couple other cases. Let me show you one more thing, because I think it's important. So we have two versions of this force model. I have this one in one dimension. This says the net force on an object, and force is in units of newtons. Okay. Mass times acceleration. I also have this one. F net equals change in momentum over change in time, where P is equal to MV. Okay, so this is called the momentum principle, and I think it's a little bit better way to think about it, but these two are mostly the same thing. Because look, suppose I put MV in for delta P, I get F net equals delta MV over delta t. Well, the mass is probably not going to change. So I could say m delta v over delta t. And oh, what's this? Delta v over delta t is the acceleration. And so you'd think, oh, what the heck? Why even do that then? Well, there is a reason. But first, what if the mass did change? Second, this form works in cases where that one doesn't work. It's like when you get to really high speeds and stuff like that. It's just, I don't know. I just like it. Okay. I know you're thinking, hey, let's do some problems. But no, we're not. We're going to do another conceptual idea here. Okay, suppose I have this. I got to use all my props. So this is a rocket. So it's in deep space. And it's moving this way. That's the direction of velocity. And the force is also that way. So if the force pushes on the rocket, then it will increase in speed. It will accelerate this way. It's hard to show acceleration. Let me try that again. Okay, that's what the rocket does. So one thing that this force could do would be to make it increase in this direction that it's moving. Okay, but now what about this? Let's say it's over here and it's moving this way. I was going to turn it around, but then I'll do it this way. Yeah. Okay, what if it's already moving and it turns around and it fires its rocket? Does it start moving that way? No, it's moving this way. Okay, but the force is to the left, so the acceleration is to the left. So I can be moving that way with the rocket, and it'll look something like this. That backwards pushing force is going to make it slow down. So a force pushing in the same direction as the motion will make it speed up, have an acceleration. I mean, let's just say it has an acceleration that makes it speed up, okay? Because positive acceleration doesn't really make sense here. But I can also have an acceleration that makes it slow down. In fact, I can also have an acceleration that makes it turn, but we'll look at that later. So here, let me show you this. Move is four letters. It's a four-letter word, like a lot of other four-letter words, because this rocket can do several things. It could, if I say it's moving, it could be moving this way and speeding up, okay? It could be moving this way and slowing down, or it could be, it could turn off its rockets. It could be moving this way at a constant speed. All of those are move, so you can't just say move. That's not really a great description. And then again, it could even be moving this way to constant speed, be moving this way, speeding up, and so forth. Okay, so, but this is our fundamental nature of forces. These are the really important things, the momentum principle, and you could call this Newton's second law. I don't really call them that, but whatever. And so we're going to do some problems on forces, but I want to give you a good introduction to it so you can get a big idea, and that's that. So this is chapter 2. Of Just Enough Physics. We're going to stay in one dimension. We're going to look at forces of motion. If you like this stuff, if this is what you want, you know, subscribe, like. I hate saying that, but you can do the little thumbs up thing. Does that still have that? Yeah. There's that Patreon link down there if you want to support this. I would think that would be awesome. What else? Oh, if you have feedback, if you want me to do something different, you know, let me know. I'm here for you, okay? So I will see you guys soon.